Should make for a good show.
Yeah.
Pretty cool.
We should start off with the German singing. Brigitte singing.
Dankeschön.
Bon Appetit.
As we say. Huh? Hello. Okay. Hey, Internet. I'm Chaz.
And I'm Dan. Welcome to Wine Serious Business. We have no idea what episode this is because we're shooting a bunch of videos back to back to back to back. I'll put them together later. You'll see them a week or two at a time.
Dan's trying to be quiet. But so we're filming kind of late at night here in Germany. But wanted to do this show. Since we've been in Germany, I've been really trying to seek out some Pinot Noir. It's what I'm excited about in Oregon. I mean, I'm excited about everything, but really, my heart's there. So I knew like these soils here in Germany, they can produce good Riesling, like Riesling that tastes from anywhere. Yeah. There's got to be Pinot Noir in Germany that tastes like nothing from anywhere else.
Yeah, I agree.
So we're trying to seek some of those out. So the first one we're going to start with is the 2011 Maximin Grünhäuser Spätburgunder.
Yeah.
So that's Spätburgunder is what they call it. You poured me gigantic.
Yeah, what's going to happen to you now? What's going to happen to you now?
I've been drinking already today, so this is how good shows start. So
yeah, this is the 2011. He said it's planted right within the estate vineyards, and it's just a special project of his. And we asked him, like, Pinot Noir and Riesling vineyard, huh? And he's like, big boys need big toys.
That's exactly what he said, dude. Yeah. That's hilarious.
So I think just in his heart, he wanted to give Pinot Noir a try. Probably the same thing, right? Like Riesling is famous as a transmitter of terroir, so is Pinot Noir.
Right.
He wanted to see what happened. We also wanted to see what happened. And Chris, one of our regular viewers, the writer of the Wineside blog, made a comment and said that he thinks this might be the first commercial release of Maximin Grünhäuser Spätburgunder. So.
What was he doing with it before?
The new vines.
Oh, the brand new vines. So, okay. All right, cool.
So fun to try if that's the case. So,
yep.
Here we go.
God, these glasses suck.
It smells like Pinot Noir, though, honestly. It smells Oregon ones.
It smells similar.
Yeah. I'd like to think I'd be able to pick the variety out blind there.
Yeah, really correct. Sort of like a ripe, like a sense of like ripe black cherries.
Totally.
A little bit of blackberry fruit.
Dark black earth too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a little bit earthy. Who knows? A little bit of a sense of richness as well. Yeah. You get these in some Pinot Noirs from Oregon, but like the richness is sort of an outlier, or is a part of all the fruit characteristics to me. Like it's not like sometimes you get acidity in the nose or something like sharpness or tartness, there's none of that. Like, it's definitely like a rich.
Definitely fruit. A bit of oak showing through here too, but not like, oh god, what's going on? Just like, a little bit of supporting character to it.
Mm-hmm.
I think I like it a little better. We can make another bottle earlier, right? At Popping Pour. Mm-hmm. Now that it's opened up, it's kind of nice.
No, this bottle I think is showing better. I think there's got to be some bottle variation or something. Because we popped this one, I was like, I like this bottle way better than the last one we opened. Also good in where our palate's worth the time, so.
Definitely those ripe cherries again. No problem with ripeness on this. I think a lot of people would say, this is the Ruhr Valley, of course, not the most, a little bit south, but a lot of people wonder if we get ripe enough. I don't think there's any question if this got ripe enough.
No, absolutely not.
Yeah, just dark fruit flavors again, dark earthy soil.
Yeah, in the sense of richness we was talking about on the nose, is a bit evident on the palate. Like, it's not overly rich, like pie cherries or like a jamminess or anything, right? Like, it's still got a good sense of freshness. There's good backing acidity. There's a little bit of like tannins, like black tea tannin or something.
A little bit, not tannic,
that. But really light, but like the fruit is definitely there, right in the forefront. And it's a pleasing wine. Like it's very easy to drink.
Yeah, maybe a little more oak than my taste usually run with, but not enough that it's really a problem for me.
I'm not getting the problem with the oak. I mean, it's there. For me, when Dan points it out, I see it, but beforehand I wasn't paying attention to it.
And there's a nice little touch of acidity. Again, I wouldn't describe it as a strongly acidic wine, but there's just enough in there that gives the food a little bit of zip, keeps it alive.
Just on the finish, yeah.
And in that way, I think it's balanced pretty well. And I like the fact that the tannins aren't too bitter. So, pretty solid stuff.
Yeah, it's nice wine, honestly.
Yeah.
But not something that, like just like Dan and I had said originally, this is something like a wine that I've seen from California, from Oregon, from Washington. I don't know if I would be able to, or from Oregon. I'm not sure I'd be able to pick this out in a blind tasting. Like this is Germany.
That's really interesting, actually. Yeah, I there's nothing going on with it that strikes me as unusual in contrast to the Pinot Noirs I'm used to. Of course, I need to drink a lot more Pinot Noir to get a feel for what German terroir can bring to the table. But I think, boy, for a first effort, it's actually quite
good. Yeah, it's really enjoyable. Yeah, I mean, this is good Pinot Noir. I think anyone would be in Oregon would be really pleased to drink this. Like someone who really enjoys Pinot Noir would like this.
Yeah, it's just for the, to end up with something else. So cool stuff.
Yeah.
I'm sure sometime down the road we'll get the trend of the bottle, and I look forward to seeing what happens at the vine's age. So.
All right, so our second bottle is, we went to a wine shop. I was looking for more Spätburgunders to try, or Pinot Noir, and wasn't finding a whole lot while we were tasting. So we went to a wine shop. Markus Molitor is kind of a big name in Germany.
Yeah.
For reasons, yeah?
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
Okay, so, but they had some really good, one of the wine shops there had some really high-end Pinots from him. So this is the 2009 Brauneberger.
Mandelgraben,
one star. So, yeah.
So it's not the most expensive one either. So this isn't this definitely is one of his top ones, but
pretty close. I mean, it's a $50 bottle of wine.
Was it
38 euro?
I guess so. Yeah.
So
and I will say the best German Pinot Noir I have had was from him at Zeltingerhof about a year ago. I think it was 2007. It was really delicious. So I was excited to try this one. The other benefit to the show is that we don't have to fly home with these bottles.
And,
Riesling bottles are so much lighter.
Yeah. Well, I really wanted to drink this wine on the show to find out whether I need to buy another bottle or two from this producer. Like, is it actually good stuff? And this is stuff that we don't pick up in America.
That's true.
Or at least in the Portland market or something.
Yeah.
All right. So.
Also, another nice nose. Man, I'm getting more dark fruits again.
Mm-hmm.
This was a little more forest floor on this, a little more funk going on.
Yeah, this smells almost like a little bit reminiscent of the forest floor. None of the hay or the like barnyardy scents. Like this is definitely a darker forest floor, a little like damp, but a sense of stemminess to it too, and then a sense of I want to say minerality. Like it's like I can think about it and think about slate soils, but at the same point, like I don't know that that's what I'm smelling, right? It's like it's just there's a darker characteristic to this. It's a little leaner and a little like racier. I don't know.
So. It's a nice nose, definitely pleasant. I think definitely Pinot Noir too. So.
Maybe a little floral, like the red tea rose petal thing. I don't know. It smells awesome.
This was a little more austere on the palate.
Very austere on the palate, yeah. It's
definitely getting a little more tans. Like the cherry flavors are there, but they're a little subdued, kind of a little flat. Definitely not like too overripe or sour or anything like that. They're just a little gentle, and the structure comes up above them, I think, towards the finish.
I totally agree. And a little bit of heat on the finish as well.
Yeah.
Just a little bit, but it's got a little bit of seediness to it, like a little bit of woodiness to it. It's like a pomegranate or like a cranberry, like heavily pitty.
Just full tans. I mean, like black tea on the mid palate, and they kind of go towards the finish. They kind of push the fruit off to the side. So two things with that. Like right now, it's a little too strong for me. However, they're not like really bitter or off-putting, so I could see maybe another year or two in bottle, giving this some more time for those to fall back a bit. Whether the fruit fades off too much with it, I can't say.
That could be a worry, though. I mean, considering the Grünhäuser wine, like the fruit is there and there's some weight and some substance on the palate. Like this is actually a fairly thin wine for being, or not thin, I shouldn't say, just lean on the palate.
Like
it's not weighty.
Yeah.
For for being the wine it is. So, yeah, I don't know. It's in a strange place, this wine.
And I think people, I know there are people who like a little more tannic grip in their wines, and you know, this definitely brings that to the table.
Yeah, if you're used to like young Burgundy wines.
Sure.
Like this wouldn't bother you at all.
You know, that's totally, a lot of Burgundy wines definitely have a little more of that tannic punch to it. This is definitely in line with my limited experience there. So.
I would agree. So, but the fruit flavors that are there, while they're a little austere, are nice.
Yeah.
There's a little bit of floral characteristic to it too. I'm still getting a little bit of roses, young roses. Other than that, structurally, it's a powerful wine still. So.
Yeah, still enjoyable. I drink another glass of it for sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah, enjoy it.
Do we even score these, or are we
no?
I really like the Grünhäuser wine. Like it's drinking really nice now. I agree with Dan. Like at this point, if I had more of this, I would sit on it a few years and just see what happens.
Exactly. Yeah.
So. Cool. All right. So the last one.
Yeah. I need a rinse here. It's okay. Our viewers are used to that.
The cold juice makes it all better.
Yeah. So. This is some crazy stuff. We don't see it in the States. I'm kind of surprised that we don't see it in Oregon. I think a lot of producers would.
Now that I know about this one, why don't we see something like this in America?
I really don't know.
I think Americans would love this product. I mean, honestly.
That's our question of the day, by the way, so we'll come back to it.
Yeah.
Because it really is. So this is called Federweisser. This is young, fresh wine. Trying to think. So Weingut S, Scharfbillig. From Ingel. I don't know anything about these guys, but this is a product that this time of year in Germany you see all over the place. And it's fresh, young, fresh wine. The fermentation started. You can see it's super cloudy. That's because the yeast is still in there. They sell it to you with just foil over the top with a hole in it, no cork, because the yeast is still just cooking away.
Yeah.
So it's just young, fresh wine, straight from the barrel. And for those of you who have been involved in winemaking, know that grape juice is delicious.
It's so fun going, like, having done bottling and harvest a couple times, like when you go to a place where you're working and then you're like, oh, let's drink something out of the fermenting tank.
Yeah.
And you're like, that sounds weird. It's like, that's about 4-6% alcohol. Here's some juice, and it tastes just like the best fruit, best fruit juice. You're like, I just want to drink this at breakfast.
A little bit of CO2, you know. Yeah, so,
Wolf for Zion.
They're making a product out of it, which I think is pretty cool.
That's awesome.
Smells like a bunch of smashed up fresh apples and pears, I think. You just put them in a bowl, mm-hmm. smash them all up. A little bit of lemon juice on there.
Hints of citrus, yeah. I say the citrus is like a little bit of a lemon juice thing. And then maybe because I've been eating too many Riesling grapes, but just like there's a grapiness to it too. Like
yeah.
Skins, big time skin.
And, you know, nothing complex here. This is totally just like fresh, fun, sweet.
That's just so good.
Yeah. It's really refreshing.
Why don't I drink more of this in America?
Yeah, just great fruit flavors. Some people do it with Riesling. I've heard that other people like the bulk, or a large bulk of this stuff is from grapes that ripen fast and so are used mm-hmm. specifically for this. I don't think they declare the grapes on this one here.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm guessing it's not Riesling, right? Because it's more of a premium product. That's usually ripe a little bit later.
Mm-hmm.
But probably be a little better just because we're partial to Riesling. But I think, man, I think like if someplace, like you could just do a small keg of like Pinot Noir stuff like this.
Ooh.
At like, you know, really fine, high-end restaurant or something like that, I think it would fly. It's a good place.
I totally agree.
Yeah, you want to taste fresh Pinot Noir from any number of producers, right? That'd be awesome.
I mean, this tastes honestly like a fruit juice. It's like sort of like apple or like a pear apple. Yeah. Like there's an American producer of juices that does like different like pineapple mango and like all these different where they press juices together. This sort of tastes like a apple pear cantaloupe mixture of juice. I mean, it's just juice. Like just
yeah, the yeast has a little bit of weight in the back, but.
Don't say there's any alcohol in it,
no.
And it just like has a small amount of fizz to it. Like you can tell there's texture there added from a small amount of carbonation, but
the acidity is great.
Yeah,
fresh. This tastes like fruit.
Yeah.
This tastes like fruit.
Yeah.
Ken Palo, if you did this with Chardonnay, oh, it'd be so good. Right?
How, I don't think it's even possible to get anything back to America, is it? Oh, yeah, it'd blow up.
Actually, with the pressure differential on an airplane.
Okay, yeah. That'd be so rad to, like, basically get it home, rush it out.
I bet a lot of people watching the show have heard of it or had it before, but, yeah. But it's fermenting wine straight from the barrel. And so, put in a bottle, sold to consumers, and it's delicious.
So. Agreed. So, yeah, that's our show.
Cheers. Thanks for watching. Question of the day, right?
Like, why isn't there any more of this in America? And if there is, do you know about it?
Yeah.
If there is there anybody selling this?
Because we
saw something like it.
Because we like to
drink. Yeah, it's awesome. So, cheers. See you guys next time.